Do you know what a servo is? A servo is a small device that has an output shaft. Servos are extremely useful in robotics and modeling. If you are into one of these areas, you probably will face a question. How to test our servos? In this video, I want to show you different ways to test them, including radios and receivers, servo testers, battery meters, and the DI circuit. So, let's get started. The first and easiest way to test our servos is using radio and receiver. Let me show you how it works. Here is our receiver. This specific one has got 6 channels, and here in this side we provide power to the board, and in the other side here you can see the polarity indication. That means the outer pins are always negative. I'm going to hook up the servo to the channel 1. You guys can choose any other channel. The black cable goes in the outer pin, that's the negative one, and now we hook up our supply cables and you provide 6 volts to the receiver. Our servo is working well. Before showing you the next way, let's analyze the nature of the signal we have in our receiver when you move the sticks of the radio. So let's hook up cables to the signal and ground pins of the receiver and analyze with the oscilloscope. The nature of the signal is a pulse modulation, with a duty cycle about 90% and frequency of 50 Hz. The angle of the servo is determined by the duration of the pulse. If you have got no radio, let's see the next way to test our servos. The next way to test our servos is using one of those little boards. It's a servo tester. This specific one costs less than $2. So let's have a closer look. In this side, we provide power to the board. As you can see, you can provide between 4.8 and 6 volts. On the other side, we have our output signal, positive and negative. Now, let's hook up the cables and see how this little tester works. Thank you. Let's test our servo. Once again, it's working well. The servo test has this manual function, but also a automatic function. We can access here in the left hand side of the board. Before jumping to the next way to test our servos, let's also analyze the nature of the signal we have here. That's the signal the servo tester is sending to the servo. As the previous one, we have a duty cycle about 90% and a frequency of 50 Hz. So that's the nature of signal that drives a servo. The next way you have to test our servos is using a battery meter. They usually have a servo test function built in. What you have to do is connect the servo in the nickel cadmium port. So we place the servo in here and we can test it. So let me show you how it works. The first pin is the negative pin. The second pin is the positive one. And the third pin, it's our signal. We have to provide power to our servo and also to the battery meter. We could make a cable adapter, but let's use a breadboard. The signal pin we can connect straight to the servo cable. We don't need the breadboard for that. When we power up our battery meter, it's just showing the voltage comes from the power supply. To access the servo test function, we have to press the self button and hold for a couple seconds. So now we are able to test our servo. To move the servo, we have to press and hold the buttons in the right and left hand side. Before moving to the next step, let's analyze once again the signal that comes from the battery meter. That's our already known pulse modulation. In order to drive the servos, The tester sends the same kind of signal to the servos with a duty cycle of about 9% and frequency of 50 Hz. It's gonna be important to know that in order to make our own tester. The next way to test our servos is making our own circuit. This one is based on a 555 timer. Let me show you the schematic. That's our circuit, and it's probably the easiest circuit we could come up with. As I said, it's based on a 555 timer and few other components. The 555 timer itself is quite affordable, and you can find it in any local store or in the internet. I will provide a couple of links in the description down below. As you see, this circuit works fine, but you guys may not find the same values I used here. So I also would like to show you how to calculate different values for your components and get the same results. The secret is always in the datasheet of the components. Here we have the 555 timer datasheet. If you guys look here inside, you guys will find all the answers we need to make our own servo tester. First, you guys should look for the ASTBOL operation of the 555 timer. After that, you guys should find the formula for the charging time of the capacitor, what gives us the high output we need to drive our servos. I don't have many options of ceramic capacitors in my lab, so I start giving the highest value I had on hand, and I calculate the values for the resistors. Of course, I also decide which pot to start using. As you guys saw in the datasheet, that's the formula you have to use to calculate our components. So here, R1, we have two resistors, because we have our pot in series. And the second resistor, we want to calculate. We know that our servos work at 50 Hz. And you also know that frequency is given by 1 divided by period. So our period is 1 divided by 50. It gives a value of 20 milliseconds. Now, if you place this value in the formula, we will be able to find out the value for the components. For R1, as I said, I decided to use a 20K pot in series with a 10K resistor, which gives us a value of 30,000 ohms. So you want to find out the value for R2. I also decided to use a 100 nanofarad capacitor, was the highest value I had on hands. So if we solve this equation, we are able to find the value for R2. I found a value of 320K, and I used a 330K resistor, was the closest value I had. Let's see the result on the oscilloscope. As you guys can see, we have a frequency of 50 Hz and a duty cycle of 9%. The same kind of pulse modulation the other testers were sending to the servo, so it should drive well our servo. So let's test it. To analyze how change values can affect the signal we get in the end, let's rearrange this formula and see, for example, what happens when you change the value for R2. So R2 is given for this formula. Since we have got a fixed value for the capacitor and resistor, it means if we increase the value for R2, we're gonna have a higher value of period, that means a lower frequency. So if we decrease the value for R2, we're gonna have a lower period, which means a higher frequency, since frequency is given by 1 divided by period. So lower period means higher frequency. Let's see on the scope. Instead of 330k for R2, let's use a 70k resistor and let's see how it affects our signal. As expected, we have a higher frequency, 200 Hz. Now let's use a 34k resistor, we should get a higher frequency. And here you guys can see we have 400 Hz, it's a higher frequency. You guys also might ask why you need a resistor in series with the pot. So let's take this resistor off and let's see what happens with our signal. Now we have a lower value for R1, but also when the pot is completely off, we have no value for R1, that means we have no pulse. One last thing you guys might ask is why you need a decoupling capacitor between the VCC and ground. Let me show you on the scope what happens when we take off our decoupling capacitor. We get noise in our wave. Noise caused by the other circuit elements. So the decoupling capacitor short the high frequency noise, giving us a better wave. That's it guys. If I couldn't explain something well, please leave your comment in the comment section down below. It will be a pleasure to clarify any unclear point. And if you like this video, please thumbs up, subscribe to receive notifications for the next videos, and I will catch you next time.